or trying to classify data that we have at the university about students, statistics, origins of students, maybe the follow-up of students in order to try to guess, which are, the bachelor or the master diplomas at the universities that lead to better, say, future professional careers and so on. So this is about data. There is no dynamics on it, okay, apparently. And then what I'm trying to explain today is how, if you combine what you know from continuum mechanics and then, the tools of control theory, you can actually build dynamical systems that allow you to better understand and better manipulate this data, right? And these are the neural differential equations. But the difference with respect to mechanics is that somehow in mechanics, we follow this classical idea of Galileo that said the world, the universe is written in the language of mathematics, while here, so then we understand that there is an equation for the wind and an equation for the water, okay? And this is what mathematicians and physicists have pursued for many years and centuries, so to develop all the modeling techniques of continuum mechanics, also quantum mechanics, of course, and all variants of the fields of the broad field of mechanics. While in here, we don't really know whether, the world of data is written in the language of mathematics, but it's the only language we have, right, to manipulate, to handle data. So what we do is, because the only language we have to deal with data is mathematics, we apply the mathematical techniques so to better understand and better manipulate this data. And because of that, what we try always to do is, whenever you tell me about some objective you have with the data, you are given, then I try to build a dynamical system and a control problem so that you can handle it more easily, right? You see that normally, whenever you have a database, you have questions, you have objectives, you have goals. Then you are not that far from control theory, where the aim is always to drive a dynamical system to some kind of target configuration. So here is the same. You have data, but as we said yesterday, maybe you have data of millions of citizens, but for some people you have more data than the others. Then, your objective can be that, to extrapolate data, so to get some information about those people that you didn't have any information about, right? Okay. Or compute averages, classify data, stratify population according to different parameters. There could be different goals, right? But the same happens in control theory. In control theory, as we explained yesterday, our target can be to drive solutions to equilibrium. But a different target could be, to drive the solution to a traveling wave. This is, for instance, what the surfer does in the beach, right? The surfer, is standing, is floating on water, and then sees the wave coming, and then it runs, he runs or she runs, so to catch this wave and get into the wave. Once you are on the wave, then the wave will drive you. So in control theory, you can, for instance, have as aim, controlling solutions to different trajectories. These are different goals, different objectives. The same happens in data science. You have data of different nature, and you can have different goals. Now, how do you use all the knowledge you have already in modeling, differential equations, partial differential equations, analysis, control, numerics? How do you use that in order to deal with these problems? Let me explain you this today. Okay, so before we do that, well, this is something we mentioned already yesterday. The origin of cybernetics, of control theory, as precisely the natural interface between animals and machines, right? You see, there is a very nice article that I recommend you to have a look. It's a short article, 5 pages last year, written by Alexander Fradkov, where, you know, the title is Early History of Machine Learning. And there in that article, you see, this is, of course, not the complete history. This is the perspective of this Russian mathematician. But essentially, it is correct in the sense that, you know, Professor Fradkov explains to how tightly, how, you know, closely the classical developments in optimization and control theory led, you know, to this new topic of machine learning. There is an earlier paper that we wrote back in 2003 that you can find online together with Enrique Fernandez Cara, also about the history of control theory. You know, but here we rather focus mostly on classical control theory. Okay, so it can be of interest for some of you in case you are interested to see how the different concepts and methodologies and problems developed, right? But in what concerns machine learning aspects that we don't address in this paper, I recommend you to have a quick look to this 5 pages article. Okay, good. Now, as I said yesterday, this is somehow the formulation of classical control theory. This is one of the simplest paradigms, right? So this is Professor Kalman, right? Who passed away 5 years ago. And he formulated the problem in the following manner, right? So yesterday I mentioned that quickly. Let me explain you with more detail. So if you ignore, right? If you ignore this term, right? This is just a dynamical system, x prime equal ax. So this can be a system of differential equations when x is in Rn, when we are in dimension n. But as you know, if you adopt a point of view of operator theory, a could also be the Laplacian or the Schrodinger operator, and therefore this could also be a partial differential equation, right? So once you use, you know, the notation and the principles of semigroup theory, right? Partial differential equations can be written in the same abstract framework as differential equation, of course, to the price of moving from, say, the Euclidean space Rn into some Hilbertian or Banach setting, right? Okay, but just to fix ideas, let me explain you how the controllability problem can be formulated for linear finite dimensional system. Okay, say, of course, if you give me this free dynamical system, this could be, for instance, the temperature in every office of the mathematics building in Erlangen. So I don't know, there are like 100 offices. So you have a thermostat, a thermometer in every office. And therefore you have a vector X with 100 components, which is giving you the temperature, right, in the different rooms, right? Which will not probably oscillate so much, but certainly will vary from one floor to another, depending on the orientation, whether the office is facing south or north, okay? Good. So this is a finite dimensional vector. And with this finite dimensional vector, you can describe many, many things. You could describe the political opinion of the population in a country. So for every citizen, you will allocate one component, and then you say, okay, in Spain, we are 47 million people. So you will have a vector of 47 million components with the political opinion of every individual rank from 0 to 10, from extreme left to extreme right. Okay, so it could be this. It could be, you know, also the evolution of the stock market, the different values, right? The different products in the stock market. It could be whatever you can imagine, right? Of course, this is a very simple model because A, you know, is a matrix or a linear operator, is linear model, right? So in practical applications, you will often need to deal with nonlinear problems, right? But just to give you an idea of how control theory is formulated, right? Let me explain you the problem of controllability. So now in the problem of controllability, you have a control, right? And the control is precisely BU in here. So now we don't simply have an initial datum and a free system so that the solution will simply be, right, xt equal exponential at x0 when the control is equal to zero. But actually, you have a control, right? So you have a control, and therefore, you can act on the system through the control u, which evolves in time, in a way that that you can modify the behavior of the trajectories. So one of the most classical problems in control theory, as we were discussing yesterday, in the context of models of reaction diffusion in biology, is, for instance, driving the system to equilibrium. So in this case, for instance, zero is an equilibrium, right? Why zero is an equilibrium, right? So x equals zero is an equilibrium. Why? Because, of course, a of x is equal to zero when u is equal to zero, and then, of course, x prime is equal to zero. So x equals zero is the solution of this evolution problem in the absence of control, right? So then the question is, can I, out of x0, this initial configuration, out of the initial configuration x0, can I drive the dynamical system to zero? So can I, for instance, you know, out of the very hot temperature in office these days, right? It's a heat wave, maybe 28 degrees. Can I bring down temperature to zero? Of course, for this, you need to act on the system, right? And then what Kalman said was, okay, this very simple problem, which is not so easy to handle because, you know, if I give you as an exercise, please, given this system and given an initial datum, build a function u so that the solution x at time t is equal to zero, maybe you will find that that problem is not so easy, right? Kalman said, listen, the answer to this question is given by a purely algebraic condition, which is that the rank of the matrix B, AB, AN minus 1B is equal to N. What does it mean? You see, as I said yesterday, we are typically considering situations where, you know, the vector X lives in Rn. In the context of data science and applications to social sciences, for instance, the dimension n is huge, right? It's huge because you are, for instance, considering, you know, as we said yesterday, all the pictures you have in the computer, maybe thousands of them. Okay, so the dimension is huge. Okay, on the other hand, typically the control, normally, you have many fewer parameters that you have in the state. So, for instance, the government has less policemen than citizens, right? So you don't expect that for a government to be able to manage, guarantee security and order in a country, there will be one policeman per person, per citizen, right? So you have to somehow regulate the system with a number of controls n, which is much less than the numbers of parameters to be controlled, right? Okay, so typically M will be much less than N. So then what is this matrix here? So B is what then? So B then will be a matrix which has, say, N lines, right? As many as components that are in the vector X, but only m columns, right? The extreme case will be the case where you have m equal one. It means what? When m equal one, it means that with one single control, you have to control the ensemble, all, you know, the components of the system. Yeah? Okay. Good. So now when you compute the rank of this matrix, then the first thing you should do is, one should do is to check what is the dimension of this matrix. You see, we are writing B, A, B, A square B, A N minus one B, right? And then B is a matrix that is N times M. Then when you multiply the matrix A, which is N times N, with B, which is N times M, then BA is also N times M, right? In total, you have N times M. So it means that this huge matrix here, right? This huge matrix here belongs to the set of matrices of dimension N times NM. So it means that this matrix, right? It will have N lines, right? N lines, but it will have also NM columns, many more columns in principle, right? Of course, when M is equal to one, when you have one single control on the system, this matrix is a matrix N times N. Yeah, because there is only one column for B. So here you see B is a column vector, AB is another column vector, AN minus one B is another column vector. But you see that in principle, B is given, B is the way, simply B in that particular case, where U is a scalar control, B is the vector that tells you how intensively the control is acting on each of the components of the system, right? Because, you know, I have one single control. I am regulating the heating or the air conditioning in the whole building. I am regulating it from my desk. There is only one engine, so I can only regulate the intensity of the device, but then the air conditioning, you know, circulation system has the structure of a network, and this cool air will get to the different offices in different times after going through a different path. And therefore the impact of this air conditioning system in the different rooms will be diverse, right? And therefore, you know, this impact is modeled through the vector B. I repeat, the vector B is given, is the measuring, telling you what is the efficiency of the control U on the control, on the action when acting on each of the components of the system, okay? So now if there is one control, the dimension of this matrix is N times N. And then if I ask you, what can be the rank of this matrix? Well, of course it can be at most N. And is N when the determinant of this matrix is different from zero, right? If the determinant of this matrix is equal to zero, right? Then, you know, the rank is less than N. And if the rank is less than N, then Kalman says you don't have control. So now, when does the determinant of this matrix, when is the determinant of this matrix different from zero? When is the rank of this matrix equal to N? So this happens if and only if all these vectors B, AB, A square B, AN minus one B are linearly independent. So if for some reason you were unlucky and you have chosen B, right, to be, for instance, an eigenvector of the matrix A, then you don't have the property. Why? Because B is an eigenvector. You apply A to B, and because B is an eigenvector of A, right? So, you know, something bad could be that, you know, AB is equal to lambda B. Because if AB is equal to lambda B, then, you know, this and this are linearly dependent, and therefore the rank of this matrix will not be full. Actually, when M, the control, is a scalar M equal one, you have only one chance to guarantee that the system is controllable. You need definitely that B, AB, A square B, they are all different and linearly independent. And this is the representation that Kalman gave for controllable systems. He said, listen, it looks like a dynamical property. It can be complicated because the construction of the control, you need to go up and down, and the control has to be sometimes complicated. This is like when you look to a soccer match. I mean, of course, it's not just about, kicking the ball in a geodesic way just to make the goal, right? What is interesting in the soccer game is the very complicated strategies that players have to develop, right? Sometimes circumventing, zigzagging, playing with others in an unexpected manner. Is this complexity of the trajectories that makes the game interesting, right? The same in control. Kalman didn't say that the controls are simple. Actually, the controls often will be quite complicated, difficult to compute. What he said is that characterizing controllable systems is easy, right? And this is the algebraic condition. You see, for instance, that in this statement, the time capital T doesn't appear. And in fact, the reason is that in a finite dimensional system, what you can do in time one, you can also do it in time one half. Of course, to the price of increasing very much the size of the controls. Okay? So then, if you a system is controllable, it will be controllable in any time. Okay? In short time, you will need more control. In long time, you will need less control. But the property of being controllable is completely independent of the time window. It only depends on this rank condition. Okay, so this is the principle. And now, what is the idea of the proof? What is the idea of the proof? The idea of the proof is the following. You can write, using the variation of constant formula, the solution of the control system as being, the linear part associated to the free semigroup without control, exponential at x0. Plus, we use the variation of constant formula, the influence of the control, right? And then this is, the free equation plus the influence of the control. Now, as the exponential of the matrix A, you can be expanded, in power series. Okay? And then this means that, I can always write the solution as being the free solution plus the contribution from the powers of A. Now, you see that according to Cayley-Hamilton theorem, every matrix, according to Cayley-Hamilton, every matrix is a zero of the polynomial, of this characteristic polynomial. It means that the power An, right? It means that the power An can be written, right, as a combination of alpha zero identity, alpha one A plus, 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 alpha N minus one, A N minus one. So it means that when you come here to this power series expansion, you say, okay, I have the distinct terms corresponding to K equals zero, K equal one, K equal N minus one to the power A N minus one. Right? But then the power N, K equal N, is a combination of the previous ones. And when you get to K equal N plus one, for the same reason, you can do the same, right? Because then A N plus one, which is A times A N, can be written according to the previous formula, can be written as a combination of the previous N, but the previous N are also, a combination of, the powers from, say, identity, the power zero to A minus one. So you see that all these series eventually can be written as a polynomial depending on simply identity A n minus one. But you see, all these terms are always multiplied by B. So what does this Kalman rank condition say? This Kalman rank condition says simply that, when the rank of this matrix is equal to n, basically in every time instant, you can always choose u so that the quantity you are adding to the three dynamics of the system can be pointing in any of the direction of a space you like, right? And therefore, this is really what allows you to control the system. This is like when you are driving, I mean, you are driving if there are no obstacles, you are in the free space driving, there are no obstacles, right? Then you can, you know, regulate the orientation of your car wherever in the direction you want. And therefore, in case there are no obstacles, you can get, you know, whatever you want, provided you have enough energy, enough gasoline or electricity, right? But in case there are obstacles, it means that if you are, you know, driving along a river, right, that you cannot cross the river, then there is one direction in the Euclidean space in which the car cannot be driven. This will correspond to the situation in which, according to Kalman, right, the rank is less than n minus, is less than n, is at least n minus one or less, and then the system cannot be controlled, okay? So this is slide taken from a previous presentation of my friend Jean-Michel Coron. You see, it represents what we do, for instance, in the auto school. When you are trying to get the driving permit, they teach you how to, you know, park the car, and you do these kind of operations, for instance, right? So, you know, you go forward, then you turn left, then you go backwards, then you turn right, and you don't get to the same point. So why don't we get to the same point? It's precisely because in principle, in here, you know, there is no commutativity, right? And therefore, between the matrix A and B, and therefore the enchainment of these operations can lead you to, you know, unexpected, in principle, not so obvious situations, right? Or positions or configurations. So this is very well explained in the book of Eduardo Sontag, where you will find a nonlinear system, right? The nonlinear system in which a car, you know, very simple rectangular car is described by x1, x2, the two coordinates of the center of gravity, you know, the angle for the orientation of the main axis of the car with respect to the horizontal, which is given by phi, and theta, which is the angle of the wheels, right? The angle of the wheels with respect to the main axis of the car. There are four parameters, and you have only two controls, acceleration and the angle of the gear. So two controls allow you to control a four-dimensional system. So you see, something you have to keep in mind is that thanks to this characterization of Kalman in here, the number of controls you need for controlling a high-dimensional system can be much less. And this is a very important concept when you get to data sciences, right? Because typically, data sciences, you will be dealing with huge, you know, amount of data, possibly of very high-dimensional data, right? And therefore, right, you can never expect to have as many, you know, controls as data you have. Typically, in all applications of data science and machine learning, the number of controls is much less than the number of parameters to be controlled, okay? Now, there is a very interesting paper by Jean-Louis Lyons back in 88, published in SIAM Review, when he got the John von Neumann Prize of the SIAM, of the American Society for Industrial and Applied Mathematics, where he gives a different perspective to this problem. Of course, his results are just a different way of, you know, recovering in particular the results by Kalman, but with the advantage of being very easily, you know, adaptable for partial differential equations, and even more with the great advantage of leading immediately also to computational methods. Because as I said before, is not because you have an easy characterization, as Kalman said, of the controllability in terms of a rank condition, the Kalman rank condition, which is purely algebraic, it does not mean that computing the control will be easy. As you can guess also, when the dimension of the system n is huge, even the verification of the Kalman rank condition will not be so easy. I mean, you could try yourself, right? Take MATLAB, open, you know, the linear algebra tool, and then take a matrix of a huge dimension and see whether MATLAB is able to compute the, you know, the rank of the Kalman matrix. In the control toolbox of MATLAB, of course, you have a command to compute the Kalman rank matrix. But it will work for matrices of a limited dimension. Beyond that dimension, I mean, the computer will tell you, well, I cannot. Too many computations, the course of dimensionality. So you see, when you are dealing with PDEs, how are you going to do it? PDEs are infinite dimensional. Okay, you say, well, in practice, they are not, because I discretize using finite elements. I will go down to finite dimensions. Yes, you will go down to finite dimensions, but in a huge dimension. Therefore, you know, it will be hard to manipulate anyhow, right? So what Leon said brings a lot of added understanding to the topic. He said the following. So rather than looking to the control problem, let me look to the adjoint system. Actually, Leon was following the path that Norbert Wiener, introduced when he said, you remember, he said, cybernetics is the science of control and communication. So he mentioned two dual problems simultaneously. And then Jacques Lyons followed that path. He said, let me look to the dual problem. What is the adjoint problem? The adjoint is just the algebraic adjoint. I mean, given a matrix, say you have the adjoint matrix, or you have the adjoint operator. And then in the context of differential equations, the adjoint is computed using just integration by parts. And because of that, what was x prime before now becomes minus p prime. P is the adjoint state. Of course, p is also in Rn. The dimension of the adjoint state is the same as the dimension of the original state x, right? Now, because we are reversing here the sense of time in the differential equation, the value, you know, the initial value for p is taken at time capital T. So it means that I am solving now, you know, the adjoint equation from t equal quad capital T to t equals zero, right? And then Leon said, in fact, the control of minimal L2 norm, in order to do this, he used Fenchel-Rockefeller, right, duality. He said, in case there is a control, if the system is controllable according to Kalman, maybe there are many controls. So this is like when you look to Google. I mean, you say, I want to go from Erlangen to, you know, to, I don't know, Tetuan in the north of Morocco. Then there is more than one way. There is not one single way. There are many ways to go. I could go through Paris, or maybe through Bordeaux, or maybe through Nice, or maybe through Barcelona, or through Hendaye. There are many ways to do it. But there is one which is the shortest path, right? Then Leon said the same happens in control theory. Once a system is controllable, there are many ways of controlling the system. Let me think on the way in which the L2 norm of the control is minimized, which is a very natural way to do it. In some sense, I am minimizing the energy I am burning on controlling the system. He said, actually, then this control of minimal norm that, of course, will exist once you know the system is controllable. Of course, if the system is not controllable, there is nothing to be done, right? If the system is not controllable, there is no control. Please don't ask me to compute one. But if the system is controllable, I can look for the control of minimal norm. And then Leon said, this control of minimal norm is actually the one which is given by the adjoint state P. So it's actually B star P hat, where P hat is one of the many possible adjoint states, because of course this is a differential system. Whenever you give me PT, you will have a different solution P. Therefore, you know, in order to compute the optimal, say, control, I will need just a very distinguished adjoint P, and this is, according to what Leon wrote, the minimizer of this quadratic function. So you know this from books. I mean, when you took, for instance, variational calculus, or you were doing you know, numerical linear algebra, or you were doing the introduction to PDEs, and then you use Lax-Milgram, and then Lax-Milgram says if you have a bilinear, continuous, and coercive form in a Hilbert space, and blah blah blah, and then the lemma ends saying, and when the bilinear form is symmetric, the solution can be computed as a solution of a minimization problem. This is the minimization problem. In this minimization problem, you have a quadratic form. The form is a bit implicit, but it's a quadratic form anyhow, because how do I compute this quadratic form? You give me PT. I solve the adjoint equation and I compute P. Out of this, I build P star P. And then I take one half of the integral of B star P squared, the modulus of B star P squared. Of course, when the number of controls is more than one, M is larger than one. If M is one, B star P is just a scalar. It's just a linear combination of the different components of P. When M is equal to two, there will be two components in B star P. So this modulus stands for the Euclidean, right? Norm. And then you have here the linear term where x0 is fixed. Recall, x0 is the initial datum we are trying to compute to control, which is multiplied scalarly with p0, which is the solution of this adjoint system at t equals 0. So you see that this has the typical form of the quadratic functionals, the energy functionals you minimize for solving Lax-Milgram, quadratic plus linear. What do you need in order to minimize this? You need a coercivity. And what is the coercivity? The coercivity is given by, you know, this condition. It means that, you know, and this is what is called the observability inequality, as anticipated yesterday, right? Why do we call it observability inequality? Because recall, sorry, here it should be P, right? Yeah, should be P. So as we said before, assume, for instance, the case M equal 1. M equal 1, it means the control is a scalar. So one single control. And in that case, right? You know, when you compute B star P, this is just a number. Right? This will just be a linear combination of the different components of P with the different components, right, of the control vector B, right? So in a system which is huge, in which, for instance, you are tracking the position or the opinion of every individual in a country, out of just a linear combination of them, You have to recover the full energy, the full state, the full initial configuration of the system. You see that this is very close to the classical inverse problems, where I give you very few information on a system and you have to disclose all the rest. We are doing the same here. This is an inverse problem, if you wish. And we call the observability property. So the key idea of Lyons was to say the controllability problem is equivalent to this observability inequality. So the proposal he made was, rather than looking for the control, just check whether you are able to prove this inequality. This is something that is often done using energy estimates, a priori estimates, multipliers, Fourier series, tools that we already know for ordinary differential equations and partial differential equations, okay? So he said, prove this inequality. Once you have this inequality, it means that the Kalman rank condition is fulfilled, right? And then out of this inequality, you build this quadratic functional, you minimize this quadratic functional, and you know the control will be B star P tilde. In case you decide to change the initial data to be control, if you change the initial data to be control, then what you do is you change slightly the functional, you minimize it again, and you will have the new control. You know that, you see, here we are in the finite dimensional context. Of course, when we get to PDEs, things are more tricky. But in the final dimensional context we are here, all norms are equivalent. So the fact that, you know, this is bounding the norm of PT is just a corollary of this uniqueness or unique continuation property, meaning that B star P is equal to zero implies that PT is equal to zero. So you see that the only thing you have to guarantee is that in this finite dimensional system, the B star, which is the adjoint of the control vector B, now the adjoint of the control vector B plays, you know, the role of an observer, right? The only thing you need to guarantee is that in case B star P is zero, then you guarantee that P is equal to zero. So you are, you know, there is a complex system. You have just a particular perspective to it, but somehow through this unique continuation or observability inequality, you are guaranteed that whatever you see in B star P tells you the whole truth. And you see again that there are some dangerous cases. For instance, it will be bad if B star will be perpendicular to B, to some eigenvector, you know, of A star, right? Because then if B star will be perpendicular to one of the eigenvectors of A, of course, B star P will be zero for, you know, the solution in separated variables P, which is associated to the eigenvalue lambda and the eigenvector, right? E, okay? Maybe with a minus sign here. So you see that again, how the control B is positioned with respect to the intrinsic matrix A or A star of the system is critical. So in some sense, you have to think that in a system, you know, driven by this matrix A, you are piling up many, 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 many components of different nature. They are interlaced, they are interconnected, but you don't have such a clear idea of how, because even if I write down the coefficients of the matrix A, it will be hard for you to understand out of all these linear algebra, linear combination, how, you know, dynamically the different components of the system are connected, what these conditions of Kalman or Lyon's, which is the dual condition, right? Lyon's condition is the equivalent of Kalman rank condition. This condition of Lyon's is telling you that B, the control operator or the observation operator, are somehow oblique to the system, so that you can see all the components. And it's not just something perpendicular, which will allow you to see just the first component, but not the others, right? So this is a guarantee that through B, you are penetrating and getting everywhere onto the system. Okay. So this was the you know, the great contribution of Jean-Louis Lyon's in this area. And as I said before, this has also the advantage that it becomes immediately computational, because you can, of course, say, well, I can, once I know I have to minimize this functional, I can just apply a gradient descent algorithm or a conjugate gradient algorithm or a stochastic gradient descent algorithm to minimize the functional G. Right? And because, well, I have to deal with ODEs, I will do it not in the ODE, but in a, say, time discrete version of this ODE written in terms of Euler, you know, or Runge-Kutta or so on. So this has a very natural computational counterpart. Okay, good. Now, I said something which is true, but is not completely satisfactory. Is that I said, well, in the Kalman rank condition, time doesn't really matter. The system is controllable or is not controllable. Once it's controllable in any time. It's just a matter of how much control you will use. And the shorter the time interval is, of course, the more control you will need. Okay, but we know that in practice, you know, for instance, when you go to the hospital, it's not the same to get to the hospital with an emergency, in which you really need to be treated in the coming seconds or minutes, this could be critical for your, you know, for your health, for your possible recovery if you have a heart attack or a stroke. And there are some other, you know, illnesses which are kind of chronic. Okay, you have high blood pressure, fine. But, you know, high blood pressure, if you do a sport and you do a diet and maybe you take one pill per day, can be made chronic, right? So you see that, you know, in practical applications, you know, the length of the time interval matters in the control strategy. You don't act equally in short time or in long time. For instance, if you have a very long time to write a PhD, then you can write one page per day. So I have a friend who writes many books, actually, Roberto Rodriguez, the one who wrote this biography of Felix Klein. I asked him, so how do you write so many books? And he said, well, it's very simple. If you write one page per day, every year you have a book of 365 pages. It's just one page per day. But of course, it has to be a perfect page, right? Okay. And then if you say, no, no, but I don't work Saturday and Sunday. Okay, you just do one page per day from Monday to Friday. And then at the end of the year, you will have a book of 250 pages. So if you think that way, then a PhD should not be that difficult, right? Because you can do a PhD with, say, I don't know, 150 pages, then okay. So you write one page per day, 5 months, your PhD thesis is over. We know it's not that simple, right? Okay, good. I was introduced to this question by my former PhD student, Francisco Palacios, who is now working in Seattle, in the States, in Boeing, right? He wrote a thesis on the optimal shape design in aeronautics. And we observed that oftentimes when aeronautical engineers deal with optimal shape design problems, they are considering steady state models. And I wonder why. So why for us, aeronautics and astronautics are very dynamical processes, why often when, you know, engineers deal with them, they often consider a steady state model? The answer somehow was already cued by John von Neumann when he introduced the concept of TARPIKE. Then this concept was further developed by Paul Samuelson, who won the Nobel Prize in Economics. And he said the following. He said, you know, if when you look in Google, you know, the path from Erlangen to Tetuan, as I said, then Google immediately responds with several options, in particular, the shortest one. Okay, it will be like 20 hours or 23. And then they will give you the shortest path. I don't know what it is. This may be probably more or less diagonal crossing, you know, France and then, right, getting into Spain and then crossing diagonally Spain and then Gibraltar and so on. Okay, fine. Then you see Google doesn't ask you, okay, but please, can you tell me whether in Erlangen you are departing from home or from your office? Or whether in Tetuan you are going to the university or to the hotel? No, Google doesn't ask. You say Erlangen, Tetuan, and you get a path. Why is that? This is the TARPIKE principle. You know, when the distance between the two objectives is so long, the optimal control strategy is essentially just take the highway. And then the only thing you need to do, depending on, you know, the day of departure and the circumstances and arrival, just, you know, build an initial arc, right? This is the strategy, the TARPIKE strategy, just take the highway. The only thing you need to do is, of course, a small exercise in the beginning to jump into the highway. And when you are getting to destination, get out of the highway to get to your home, you know, without losing too much time. So this is the principle that they cue. They said, you know, in long time intervals, optimal control strategy are nearly a steady state. And then the only thing you have to do to build a nearly optimal control strategy is to, from the initial position, jump into the steady state, remains there, and then exit again. Okay, this is the TARPIKE principle. So, of course, there is a lot to be done in order to understand this completely from a linear, from an analysis perspective. We have done some work, I started working with this with Alessio Porretta in Roma, Tor Vergata back in 2013, a PhD student in our team, Dario Piguin, just wrote a PhD thesis. He's now working as a researcher in Sherpa Artificial Intelligence, an artificial intelligence company in Bilbao, right? But you can easily gather the principle. The principle is the following. You have to control a system in a long time interval. Then the best you can do is use essentially controls which are a steady state, which are very simple because they are independent of time. And then the only thing you have to do is jump in, stay there, and then get out. Okay? So now, for instance, if you make an appointment in the airport with a friend or a family member, you are flying from one city, the other one is flying from another city, and you are gathering in the airport in Paris, what do you say? You say, okay, we gather in the meeting point of the airport. So when you get there, you go. When the other one gets there, he goes or she goes, and then you meet there. When you travel, what do? You rush to go to the train station, you take the train, you stay on the train for hours, and then when getting to destination again, you quit the train station to go back home or to the hotel. So when you rush, to get to the, to class, and then your classroom is in floor number 10, what do you do? Oh, you rush to the elevator. Then you take the elevator to floor number 10. There is nothing you can do. I mean, you can watch the numbers going 1, 2, 3, up to 10 very slowly. Maybe you like the elevator to move faster, but there is nothing you can do. You cannot pedal to make, the elevator to move faster. And then once you get out of the elevator, you rush to the class. So we live always on turnpikes. However, when Glowinski and Lyons in the 80s, they computed controls for heat equations, they realized that oftentimes this control look very oscillatory, do not have the turnpike phenomena. Why it was? Well, the reason is the following, is that when you are controlling a heat equation like in here, so this is a model that now, of course, doesn't enter into the paradigm of Kalman, because it's not finite dimensional, but still the algebra looks the same because I could say that, minus the Laplacian is just a linear operator, right? Sorry, going backwards. I could say that minus the Laplacian is a linear operator. So I can apply the ideas of Lyons that they, based on observability, duality, and minimization, are universal. They apply equally for finite or infinite dimensional systems. And then when I apply this, then I discover that, of course, the control F is given by an adjoint state. And the adjoint state is this adjoint heat equation. But what does this adjoint heat equation do? This adjoint heat equation does the same as the heat equation, but in the reverse sense of time. And what does the heat equation typically do? The solutions of the heat equation, if the initial datum changes sign, will oscillate and will go down exponentially. So this is why the P grows exponentially. And then we said, well, then it seems there is a general principle by von Neumann and Samuelson that in most processes, controls should look this way, in which they stabilize for most of the time interval. But when I go to the heat equation, I don't see it. Why is that? Is this because we are in the context of PDEs? No. Is simply because when we built the optimal control, we forgot also to penalize, right, the state. When you penalize the state on the system to be, on the functional to be minimized, sorry, then you see that the state equation and the adjoint equation are coupled. And therefore, now this forward-backward heat equation has a double spectrum, right? It's a two-dimensional system, so you somehow, multiply the spectrum of the classical heat equation by two. And when you look carefully, what you see is that part of the spectrum is to the left and part of the spectrum is to the right. And this is precisely what explains the turnpike phenomena, right? Because you see that now, what is this initial arc? This is a stable arc, Here you are developing a dynamics in which you are converging to an equilibrium. So this corresponds to the part of the spectrum of the system, which is to the left of the complex plane, you enter the steady state, and then you exit the steady state through an arc, which is now corresponding to the right half of the complex plane in which the eigenvalues are unstable. Okay, good. So you see that in here, just a final comment, I didn't discuss very sophisticated controllability properties for the heat equation. I did it as very often practitioners do. You know what practitioners do? They say, okay, you have a heat process. You know, I'm looking to the temperature in this chamber omega, in this building, capital omega, where we are living. The heating or the air conditioning device is localized in a small omega. I'm acting in a small omega, and I hope that this will have a complete impact on the whole domain, capital omega, in which I'm trying to regulate the temperature y. And then you tell me that you want to achieve a temperature y star, for instance, 19 degrees everywhere. How do I do? Well, a possibility is, okay, we can do controllability. It could be very sophisticated. But if you are a practitioner, what you will do is you simply minimize this functional, in which you minimize the compromise between the control, the cost of the control, F squared, and the distance of the solution to the target. Okay? Now, as I said before, this is sufficient when your goal is just to guarantee that you get to the target. But if you want to guarantee that you also have a tarpike principle, so that, you know, rather than, you know, driving from Erlangen to Tetuan, you drive along very complicated paths, but you take really the highway, then you should also penalize a little bit the state. Maybe someone will tell you, well, but I'm not interested on the profile of temperature during the time interval. I'm just interested on the output at the final time. Well, yes, but normally how well you get to the output is also linked to how smoothly you drive along the path, right? And this is the principle of tarpike. Okay, so we have then seen how, you know, control theory for linear systems can be understood a la Kalman, can be understood a la Lyons. We prefer a la Lyons because through duality, the problem looks simpler and you can extrapolate to partial differential equations. And we have understood also a very important principle that explains, you know, why, you know, in many circumstances, the controls are nearly a steady state, right? And according to the tarpike principle. But I repeat, in order, of course, for this to be true, in order for this tarpike phenomena to be seen, you need this time interval to be long. Right? Because if I tell you, no, I have to control the system in a very short time, then, I mean, if the time that you give me is very, very short, like in here, I will not have the chance of seeing the tarpike phenomena emerging. If you really want to go to class faster than the elevator is driving you, there is a solution. You run up stars. But then you will have to run fast, because then you have to, you know, do faster than the elevator during 10 floors. And this will need that you are very well fit and you do a, you know, a strong effort, right? So if the time window for control is too short, you will not see this, say, a steady tarpike arc. The control will be purely active, but then it will have to be something really very stiff, very strong. And this is what happens when you have a heart attack, you know, and then they put a defibrillator onto you. This is like a direct delta action, right? Because either you revive, rebirth, you know, recover, you know, your pulsion immediately, or otherwise, after a few seconds or minutes, it will be too late. So then it's direct delta control. Then there is no tarpike. But when you go to the doctor saying, well, you know, I have a little bit high cholesterol, the doctor will tell you, okay, please follow this diet and come back after 6 months. So then why 6 months? Because 6 months is a long time interval in which you can experience the tarpike effect. And in any case, because we know that in every context, you know, control systems have to be revisited again and again because circumstances can change, then, right, you go back to the doctor and again, they will, you know, give you a different program for 6 months. So you see how chronic diseases is like tarpike, while medical emergencies are short time controls in which the actions will rather be like very, very active direct deltas, right? In which, of course, the tarpike paradigm doesn't operate. Okay, so with this, we have already all the ingredients to discuss in the next few minutes about machine learning. But maybe before that, we stop 5 minutes or so. Imad, what do you think? Can we start again at 11:10?
Yes, it will be a good idea. Maybe also for participants to think on this first part, and if they have any question, they can ask it. So we'll take 5 minutes break.
Okay, 11:10. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Eric. Okay, as Professor Zahid say, you can ask your question directly in the chat, and you can also demand if you want to ask it directly, we can activate your mic. Okay, there is one question from Abdelhakim Dhamani. We will begin with this in further second part of the lecture of Professor Enrique.
Okay, on continue.
Oui, Enrique, juste il y a une petite question. Oui, donc il est dans le chat. Donc c'est does the twin peak principle give more accurate results than classical method of control theory? What are its advantages and disadvantages?
Okay, very good question. So you see, as I said above, when a system is controllable, there are many ways of controlling the system. So what is the advantage of the TARPI principle? Is that, you know, in some sense, TARPI controls have a simpler structure. So TARPI control is like, you see, when the flight, when the airplane crosses, you know, when you are taking a short flight, the pilot has to be very active. But when you are taking a long transoceanic flight, you know, the pilot will operate, you know, in the beginning when taking off from the airport, departure, and then landing, arrival. But in the, when crossing the ocean, right, you know, the basically the, you know, the aircraft will be driven in an autonomous mode, right, by a previously, you know, programmed trajectory and parameters. So the same as I said before, if you are given a diet or some kind of you know, treatment from your doctor for 6 months, you understand that it's much easier to follow a treatment in which you have to take one pill per day. If I tell you that the treatment is Monday, you take one pill, comma two at 8:13 in the morning. Tuesday, you take one pill, comma 75, but you have to do it at 3:27 in the evening. Wednesday, you take 0.49 pills, but you have to do it 2 a.m. It will be very complicated to do. So it's much easier when they tell you one pill per day, every time, you know, with breakfast or lunch. No, then it's very simple. You just do it. This is the great advantage of TARPI. Simplicity. And whenever something is simple, you know, also it's much more stable, it's more robust. So it's harder to fail when you employ a TARPI strategy, right? This is why, you know, when you are driving, I mean, if you are driving on a highway, empty, 100 kilometers per hour, straight line, well, you are in a TARPI mode, it's very hard to have an accident. Now, if you try to drive a Formula One, then you can, and then you will see how you fail, right? So why Formula One is difficult? I mean, if it was easy, everyone would be driving a Formula One car. Now we don't, because, you know, when you are 300 kilometers per hour, details matter a lot, right? This is the idea. TARPI is like the slow, conservative mode, which is extremely good and optimal in long time horizons, versus the very active mode in which you are, you know, on a risk, high risk emergency, acting through direct deltas, but then the situation is very risky, right? This is where you are really in between life and death. And then the interface is of course important, right? Because if the doctor succeeds, means life. If the doctor is not able to succeed in the very short time window that is given in order to stabilize the person that has this accident or a stroke, it means death. This kind of bang, bang, you know, very dramatic situation doesn't appear when you are in a TARPI mode. Right? Okay. Thank you for your interesting question. Now, what is this, you know, what is the link of all this with machine learning? As I said before, I indicated this paper by Fradov, where you see that machine learning has a lot to do with optimization and control. So, and in some sense, I mean, the keywords machine learning, they mean what? Well, we want to make machine learns to do things that we spontaneously do. Actually, when we build, you know, airplanes, aeronautical sciences is about the same. We are trying to build machines that mimic birds flying. And there is a lot of control theory on it. So there has to be a lot of control theory on machine learning. Let me show you this very classical result by Sivenko, which is published back in 89 in this journal, Math Control Signals and Systems, in which, I mean, I invite you to, you know, submit articles. It was founded by Eduardo Sontag that we mentioned before. And nowadays is the editor-in-chief is Lars Grüne in Bayreuth here in Bavaria next to Erlangen. So this paper said the following. Sivenko's article, this approximation by superposition of sigmoidal functions is also called universal approximation theorem. You can find it in the Wikipedia. What is the universal approximation theorem? It says the following. Take a sigmoid function as described here, right? Sigma is just a function which is taking value 0, right? And 1. So yesterday, this was the profile of a traveling wave. So now it has nothing to do with biological sciences or a traveling wave. It's just a function. For instance, it could be arc tangent. Okay, a function taking asymptotic value 0 to the left and 1 to the right. And then he said, let me consider all these possible combinations. So n is arbitrary. So what are you doing? You are taking sigma. And then with this parameter theta j, right, you are shifting, right? You are shifting sigma to the left or to the right. Okay, if when theta is positive, sigma is shifted to the left. When theta is negative, sigma is shifted to the right. Then you have this scaling parameter y, which is just making the transition of sigma to be faster or even slower. So you are just compressing or dilating the support of sigma. Okay, and then, right, you are taking a finite number of them. So it means that with different values of theta and y, you are translating and compressing and dilating sigma differently. And then you are combining them all, right, through the weight terms, right, alpha in here. So what are you doing eventually? Well, eventually you are building a smooth approximation of a simple function. What is a simple function? You remember in measure theory, simple functions are dense. And they say, you know, simple functions are piecewise constant. So basically, with such a sigmoid and this exercise, you can approximate piecewise constant functions. Why? Because in particular, when you take sigma, like this, and you compress the interface more and more and more, right? Eventually, this will converge to a Heaviside function or a jump function. So it means that by, you know, making these linear combinations of sigmoids translated and compressed or dilated, you are actually building a smooth approximations of simple functions. Therefore, you are building a dense set of functions. And this is what Sivenko said. When given any sigma, you are allowed to do all these linear combinations, then you build a dense set of data functions. So you say, well, I knew other results on dense functions, right? So the first one we know is it's Stone by Strass, right? The Stone by Strass says, polynomials are dense in the space of continuous functions. This is density. Polynomials are dense. Then when you do PDEs and you learn about the spectral decomposition of the Laplacian, the book says, well, because the Laplacian is a symmetric operator with compact inverse in a Hilbert space, then the eigenfunctions of the Laplacian constitute a dense set of spaces like L2 omega, Sobolev spaces, H1, 0 omega, and so on. Oh, good. So Fourier series, basically, right? A spectral decomposition of the Laplacian is dense also. There are many other dense functions, right? You could also say, say infinity and compactly supported functions are dense, theory of distributions, another set of dense functions. So this is another one. Sivenko said, these functions are also dense. And the reason is that, you know, they can be used to approximate any simple function. And we know that simple functions are dense. So, you know, by the transitive property of density, sigmoid functions, when piled up in this way that we call a neural network. So, you know, well, why? I don't know, but let's call it a neural network. Then they are dense. There is a small variant of this sigmoid here, which is very much used in practical applications, is this ReLU function, right? ReLU is the rectified linear unit. And this is just the function X plus, okay? X plus. So it's the function that, you know, when X is negative, takes the value zero, right? So this is zero when X is negative and it's X when X is positive. It's the positive part of X. You see that this has the same look as, you know, the sigmoid function in here, but there is one difference. So the sigmoid function has limit one, while the ReLU has, you know, a limit which is going up to infinity. But you see, let's do the following exercise. Take a ReLU and then glue it with another ReLU. What do you see in here? Can someone tell me how, you know, to which other functions that you know?
Triangle function, maybe.
Yeah, precisely. I mean, these are the triangle functions in finite element theory. So, you know, this is really pointing towards finite element methods. So you see that, again, we understand why all this theory of Sivenko and universal approximation is not that far for many things we know, because precisely when we are doing numerical approximations of partial differential equations and we use Galerkin methods, one of the most natural ways of building a basis of dense functions are precisely finite element methods, which are in particular generated out of, say, triangular functions built on the basis of a given, say, grid. And this is, as you know, a fantastic method that somehow became much more popular than finite difference methods, in particular because of the ability of finite elements to adapt to complicated geometries. Okay? That was one of the advantages. While when you are thinking on finite difference, of course, it's very nice when you are, finite differences are very nice when you are thinking on, for instance, you know, square domains or so, but as soon as you get to domains with complicated geometries, right, and maybe perforations and so on, they are much more complicated. Okay, good. So the first point then is, okay, now again, it looks like nothing to do with the goal of doing machine learning, but this is a fundamental step. Is this universal, universal approximation. Universal approximation is just density. but density of a very specific class of functions. And we will, in what follows, discuss this rectified linear unit, which is simply x plus, as just to keep in mind the simplest possible use of machine learning. Okay, good. And now you say, well, but this is a density result. So, I mean, this course is a bit complicated. We started by the historical introduction to control theory. Then I explained to you biological problems, social problems, where you could apply ideas of control theory for, you know, reaction diffusion problems. This morning I was lecturing on, you know, more carefully about Kalman and Lyon's duality strategy and so on, the tapi principle. And now we are talking about a density result. So why density is related to control? Well, there is some relation, right? So what is control doing? Control is trying to drive a dynamical system to a final destination, right? When you are doing approximation theory, in some sense, it's similar because you have a function and you try to approximate to it. But somehow you cannot approximate arbitrarily, because then I could say, well, I mean, I just take this function. And then you will tell me, no, 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 but I mean, I can only use polynomials. And the function you have is just the exponential of x. So when you are trying to approximate the exponential of x, and I tell you, you have to do it with polynomials, then you don't have complete freedom. You can, for instance, use power series expansions, and then you get a polynomial approximation to the exponential. But you cannot say just in one, you know, in one shot, you cannot say, oh, I take exponential x itself, because exponential is not a polynomial. So in some sense, control systems, we are driving a given dynamics to a target. In approximation theorems, there is an objective to be approximated and we get to it within the class of functions under consideration. They can be polynomials, they can be Fourier series, they can be semi-finitely on compactly supported functions, or they can be these neural networks in which you make linear combinations or compressed and shifted sigmoids. Now, what is the link with the problem we mentioned yesterday? Classification problems or supervised learning, right? So this is a very nice, supervised learning is a very nice way for classification, right? So what does it, why supervised learning? Well, I would like to teach my computer to classify pictures. So what I would like is that, you know, when I show one picture of my elder daughter to the computer will understand, oh, this is the elder daughter of Enrique. So all these pictures of this daughter, independent of where they are, when, they are all gathered in the same folder. So I want to learn, I want to teach, I want that my computer learns how to classify. And then why supervise? So learning is about, you know, making the tool, you know, the device, the program, the computer program, the machine, to be intelligent, to understand how to do it well. And supervise is because I am supervising the process. How I am supervising it? Well, I have an important role to play, because I am the one that says, you know, this is like in Facebook, when you upload a photo in Facebook, I think it's Facebook who is asking, who are this person in the, you know, in the photo? Facebook is learning and you are the supervisor. So you will say, Facebook, this is me, Enrique Zuazua, and this is my friend Imad, and this is my friend, I don't know, Lasse Mania. Once you say that to the system learns. And then very likely, next time when there is another photo, the system will check and will say, oh, you know, this seems to be Enrique, or these are the two friends in the same photo as before. So you are teaching the system, you are supervising the learning process of the system. How do you do that? By saying, when you go to the photo folder, say, this photo, oh, this is my father. Oh, this is my grandmother. And then once you give this information to the system, then the system learns and is able to, by comparison, say, oh, this is grandmother, this is father, this is son, this is daughter, this is friend, this is cousin, this is professor. And then you have all the universe of picture classified into categories. So you see, I am working in a recycling plant, and I would like the machine, you know, to have a kind of a tunnel where, you know, in this plant, I can monitor it from office, right? I don't need to be working there, getting my hands dirty. I would like to monitor the process from office, supervise it. But I want that when the trucks come with waste, they put the waste into the entrance of this tunnel. And then along this tunnel, you know, the waste is immediately classified. And whatever is plastic goes to yellow, whatever is glass goes to green, whatever is paper goes to blue, and so on. You see, it's the same process as the computer classifying photos, right? This has a lot to do with control theory. Let me show you a video. Let me show you a video that a colleague of mine, Tobias Vona, sent me yesterday. Let me see if I can share the video with you. Compartir. Okay. So this is a video about agriculture. You see the images? Can you see the video?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so I can give you the name of the creator of these beautiful videos. Is Lior Patel, aerial photography. You can find that in internet. So he's an artist that is recording with the drones, right? And then you see here automatic control. So you see to which extent industrial revolution, control systems, actuation, machine learning has been efficient and has made our lives so much easier, making all these processes that will be extremely painful for humans to be assisted by machines. Okay, this is automatic control, but there is a lot of machine learning on it also, right? And there is, of course, human effort, and there is industrial revolution, and there is engineering, and there is mathematics, and there is computer science. Okay, good. So I put the name of the author of this video in the chat, then you can see others, all very beautiful. So todos, so is Lior Patel, aerial photography. Okay, good. So let me share my slides again, then go back to my iPad. Okay, very good. So how is this classification problem related with density, neural networks, and control? Well, it's very simple. So what we do, we say we have items, right? We have items to be classified here, okay? So to each item, right, I allocate a point in Rn, right? So actually I do it in R, according to the notation here, I do it in Rd. You will tell me, well, the first thing, of course, you have to know is how to represent a tomato in Rd. Well, this is not completely obvious, right? And this is the first, of course, process that is extremely important. And there is a lot of image processing in there, right? So all the theory of image processing, wavelets, compressing signals, compressing images, and so on is very important. So you need first, you know, to be able to express that this is, you know, that this is a tomato, but this is cheese. Right? So then how do you do that? Well, I mean, you can build an Euclidean space in which you put shapes, you put colors, you put texture, you put density, you put, percentage of water, you can put a smell. Okay, so you classify. Okay, good. So once every item is a point in RD, now when you give me this collection of items, so here 9, so maybe like 36, these 36 items, right, are then points in RD, right? So this is the space RD of dimension D, drawn here in 3D, but of course the dimension can be huge. I mean, when you are talking about photos of people, then, you know, you need as many dimensions as pixels are in this photo, right? So maybe the Euclidean dimension in which every item lives is large, but eventually will be put in a finite dimensional Euclidean space. This is anyhow the only thing we can manipulate in the computer, because infinite dimensions we can understand, but when it comes to the computer, we have to project always into finite dimensions. Then we have points, but we have points of different colors, right? There are the red points, there are the yellow points, there are the blue points, there are the purple points. So there are four categories. So they are mixed, they are disordered, right? So I would like to classify them. And what does it mean to classify them? It means that, for instance, right, I can map these points into the real line so that the reds go to a segment, the yellow go to a segment, the purple, sorry, right? So, you know, every color goes to the corresponding, you know, segment. Red, blue, purple, and yellow. We all understand this. What is then this? This is about building a function F. It's a function F that will take every item in RD, plastic, paper, or hamburger, bio, you know, or glass, and it will map this point into the corresponding image set, which is the set allocated to the colors. As we have shown yesterday in this first simulation I have shown you, this is like a soccer field where I have players with red t-shirts and blue t-shirts, and I say red to the left, blue to the right. So actually yesterday the Blues lost, right? In France against Belgium. Sorry for this. Okay, good. So we want to build this map. And then, as someone was asking me yesterday, where do you see control theory? There is no control theory in there. It's not even clear that there is something about density. We need to build a map. But you see, if you think as in terms of Sivenko, what did Sivenko's universal approximation theorem say? What does it say? It says that neural networks are dense. Because they are dense, it means that with these neural network functions, which are these very particular functions in which you are just making linear combinations of stretch and translated sigmoid functions, in particular based on ReLU, right, which is X plus, with these functions, you have density. Because you have density, it means that you can nearly do whatever you want. So then the next step is to say, so why don't I simply take this function F in the space of neural networks? This should suffice, because eventually neural networks are dense. Okay, let's try to do it. So there was a lot done on this. And of course, the question, of course, is difficult to do is, oh yeah, but I tell you neural networks are that way, but what do you need in order to identify a neural network completely? You need to say what is the N, so how many ingredients you combine. You need to say, once you know n, what are the alphas, right? For, you know, for 1 to n. So how do you combine the weights? You need to know what are the thetas, you know, the drift elements. You need to know what are the y's, right? Which are, you know, the compression, the interface, how much you are dilating or compressing it. You need to know all this. And this is not so easy, right? So n can be very large. I mean, if you are asking me to do something very complicated, if the function f has many, many, many items to classify, very likely the function f will have to have a complex geometry, like in here. And if the function f has a lot of complex geometry, you see there are many pieces needed. And each of these pieces is one of the ingredients here adding to n. So n can be very large. How do you do that? Well, in practice, what you do is you just say, well, listen, it shouldn't be that difficult. So I can define something like this, f n alpha theta y of x. What is this? This function is the function that to every x in R or in Rd, it associates this value, right, with, you know, the combinations indicated by the number of components n, the vector alpha, the vector theta, and the vector y. And in case, for instance, x is in Rn, then I didn't say what is sigma applied to Rn. I make it simple for you. I just do it component wise. First component of x, sigma 1x, is just sigma applied to x1 up to, you know, the d dimensions of the system. So I can make it even, you know, to be operational in the Euclidean space. Now, how do I choose this function? How do you choose this function? Well, you will simply use a least square approach, right? What is the least square approach? Well, you will look for this function, fn alpha theta y, such that when you minimize the distance of the value that this function takes on the different items to be classified with respect, you know, to the color or the class you have allocated to each item. So we call it CJ, the class. The distance of the image with respect to the corresponding label is minimized, right? And of course, there are many, many of these items to be classified, right? So maybe there are M of them. So I will just take the sum and I will minimize within the class of all possible Fs. So a lot of the efforts that have been done in the modern development of machine learning has been essentially dealing with this problem. This is a least square problem. It's just a minimization problem. And supervised learning classification is reduced to this. Just find a neural network, which is a function of this type as in Sivenko, which is able to interpolate the data xj and allocate to them the corresponding label cj in a nearly optimal manner. You see, the problem, although looks very simple, and oftentimes, you know, in mathematics, we say, well, I mean, if n, you see, all this looks very complicated, but f depends continuously on n, on alpha, on y, and theta. And if the number of parameters is finite and they are bounded well by, you know, by compactness, there is a minimizer. Yes, fine. There is a minimizer, but the challenge is to find it. The challenge is to build a machine, to build a computer program that is able to achieve this, say, supervised learning objective in an optimal manner. This is the challenge, to compute the values of the parameters. So how do you do it? Well, you do gradient descent And then people will tell you, experts in machine learning will tell you, well, gradient descent is too complicated, it's too computationally expensive because there are too many parameters. Then you will do a stochastic gradient descent, for instance. Okay, fine. But all is about building such objects. Okay, good. Then you can do that. And you say, again, no control theory on it. It's just pure optimization. I write the problem as least squares. I optimize and I understand then that this can be done. So soon after that, people said, well, why if rather than doing it as Sivenko said, right? You see, in Sivenko's case, we are piling up, right, sigmoids one after the other in a column in which you have capital N of them. So this a neural network is like, in this case, it has just a neuron, but a neuron with a very, very, very high dimension, N, is like a very complex, high, tall column. So people said, why don't we try to do the same exercise, but we do it sequentially? So people said, we could do the following. We could do the same, we could take the same sigmoid functions. We change here a little bit notation, but because we are getting closer to the control theory, but it's actually the same as, you know, the same principle as in Sivenko. Take a sigmoid, translate it with the vector B, dilate the variable X with the matrix A, intensify possibly the impact of the sigmoid with a matrix W. And then we use this as just an incremental, right? An incremental deformation of the identity. Okay, and now I do it again and again and again, like in a discrete time dynamical system in an inductive manner. And if I do that, and if you think that this parameter H, that of course can be regulated in practical applications to be one, but I could think on it as being a parameter I can tune, if I will choose this parameter H to be small, then this will be very close to this differential equation. And then people said, oh, but then this supervised learning and classification problems is about control. What is the difference of this control problem with respect to classical ones? There are several of them, and they are important to be outlined immediately, right? So the first difference is that in these dynamical systems that we are considering here, right, the nonlinearity of the system is the sigmoid. Okay, is the sigmoid. It's not a nonlinearity coming from mechanics, Navier-Stokes, Schrodinger, nonlinear wave equation, or say the, you know, some satellite moving in space in astronautic with plenty of trigonometric functions and so on. No. The nonlinearity is just the sigmoid. What about the functions BT, AT, WT? As I have shown you before, in the case of Sivenko's neural network and the same here, in which we just say, call this a deep neural network. Why? Because I am repeating, you know, the same, you know, neural network with different, say, parameters, but I am repeating again and again and again, like in a dynamical system in which I am sequentiating the actions, right? One after the other. So when I move to this ODE system, the BT, the AT, and the WT are controls. Oh, so then I am in the context of control. And what is the goal? The goal is in a given time window that I could fix ideas, take T equal one, for instance, as the time window. I would like that every initial datum is driven to the corresponding, say, class, to the corresponding location of its class. So it's a simultaneous controllability problem, right? Why simultaneous controllability problem? Because, you know, in this case, what I want is that the same ODE with the same parameters BT, AT, WT, which is the you know, the computer program that will take a photo and allocate to the corresponding folder. This is the neural ODE. This is what we call the neural ODE. Why? Because it's an ODE, but it's motivated by neural networks. Then I want that this neural ODE, the same, always with the same controls, is able to control all initial data simultaneously. So there is a clear analogy with control problem. There is also a clear difference is that, as we said before, and I have mentioned that when explaining the approach of Lyons, when you are controlling a linear system, whenever you change the initial data to be controlled, then you have also to change the control. So there is a one-to-one relation in linear problems between data to be controlled, objective to be achieved, and the control you have to employ. So here is paradoxical. We are in a completely different scenario. Now it looks that we have to, for this neural ODE, we have to be able to find controls, the same controls that are able to control everyone. And is this the way it has to be? Because in practice, you know, in this, you know, recycling, waste recycling plant I am running, I need the classification device to be able to, you know, whenever it's plastic, say it's yellow, and whenever it's glass, it's say green. It's not me that is going to say that to the machine, to the program. The program itself has learned through this supervised learning process and has to be able to say yellow plastic, green glass. So in here, you know, the same control system with the same computed control has to be able to say this point is blue, should go to the right. This point is red, should go to the left. So that we can really, you know, separate red and blue and make sure the blues go to the right and the reds go to the left, like in a soccer game. Okay, good. So as you will see, this can be done. If we were dealing with linear control systems, this cannot be done, because in linear control systems, as I said, whenever you change the initial data, you have to change the control. Here, for some reason, for neural ODEs, this can be done, meaning you can achieve, you know, simultaneous control of this neural ODE. The same control can classify all data, right? And then, you know, if you tell me, can you, with this neural ODE, take, I don't know, the 8 teams left in the Euro Cup with 8 different t-shirts. So are 11 times 8, 88 players with 8 different t-shirts that are mixed in the restaurant. And I want to classify them. Can I build a neural ODE that is able to classify these players according to the t-shirt and make sure that every player goes to the bus corresponding to the residency of the hotel of its own team? Yes, you can. And the principle is very much like in the Rubik cube, right? Okay, I will explain you this a bit more. Now, before getting deeper into why this happens, something that is deeply related to the nature of neural networks and also the geometry in the problem, let's do as practitioners do. Let's simply say, okay, as I said before, I have to address this from the perspective of least squares. If I am trying to do it through neural ODEs, I will allocate a label for every initial datum, and then I will try to minimize a function in which I am penalizing the state, I mean the control, but also the distance to the final label. When I do this, I get the videos that I have shown you yesterday. And you see that the controls that I get are rather nice. They are nearly constant after some time. Why is that? Well, because of the Tarpeyke principle. When computing these controls, I have penalized the trajectory all along the time interval. While if I do it in a, you know, in other ways, you know, I might see, for instance, more complicated geometries or dynamics of the system. Classification is achieved, but not only always in the same way. Sometimes the trajectories are more oscillatory than the others. What's going on? Well, it's the same as in control theory. Lyon said, once a system is controllable, there are many possible controls. And I will work with the control of minimal L2 norm. And this is the one that is given by this duality principle. But there are other controls. In principle, we have seen that when you are in the long time interval, if you want to keep the tarpike principle, you have to choose the cost functional that you are minimizing for building the control in a suitable manner, penalizing also the state. The same in here. Once you have discovered that supervised learning is about the simultaneous control of a nonlinear system driven by a sigmoid, then you can apply all you know. And you can control the system in a way and in many different ways. And each way will have advantages and inconveniences. In some cases, it will take longer, but it will be more robust. In some others, it will be more rapid, but it will be more oscillatory. In some cases, like in here, you will observe that there is some small, you know, defect here. So you see a red point that was not well classified. Well, you know, of course, because we are just solving an optimal control problem, not an exact control problem. In the machine, even though you can exactly control the system, in the machine, you never look for the exact control. You just try to minimize the distance to a given epsilon. And after all, you know, the computer decided that this point, red point being here with the blues is not that bad because there are many, many reds. And the algorithm was successful with all of them except for this one, which is not that far anyhow. Okay? But we could tune the parameters or keep the control time a bit longer so to make sure that this red comes also down with the others. Okay? You could do that with more colors. So this is an example with three colors. As I said, you could do it with the eight colors of the teams left, you know, in the Eurocup. This is done with three colors. And again, right, this is done with three colors. These simulations are due to Borjan Geskowski, who wrote a PhD in our team last month, and now he's also working in Sherpa artificial intelligence, right? So he was the one who made these very interesting videos that helped really to understand what is the link between supervised learning and control, right? Okay, good. So I will stop here now and we can discuss, if you wish, a little bit. Anyhow, I think there is another lecture in 2 minutes, so we don't have much time. So far, please keep this message. I hope I answered to the question raised yesterday, which is very important indeed. What is the link between machine learning and control? Of course, much more could be said, but I think you can gather this. Control and machine learning are linked through this very simple problem of classification or supervised learning and this neural differential equation and its control. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Enrique, for this nice lecture. It is always a pleasure to assist of this kind of interesting topic. So I don't know if you have some minutes for question or you have something else to do after this.
No, we can. You can ask me some questions. Yes.
Okay. Okay. So I will ask to our participants if they are any question. But this is just thinking. There is here in there is this paper for null ordinary differential equations. I have a question if there is some perspective for null partial differential equation. Maybe that this A will be an operator. Are there any sense in your opinion, Enrique?
Can you please repeat again? So you said operator.
Here we have the matrix AK.
Yeah.
For example, if we can this, we can have some perspective to have, for example, an operator in this sigmoid function. This is like.
Well, okay, so that's a very good point. Indeed, I mean, this is related to mean field approaches, right? So you could think, for instance, like you do in when you are doing hyperbolic equations, you say, you see, this is related to neural transport. I will come back to this maybe tomorrow a little bit, but I mean, it's a very interesting point. These are solutions of the ODE. Yes. Solutions of the ODE, you can think also as them as being the characteristics of a transport equation. So somehow behind this neural differential equation, there is indeed a neural transport equation. So the neural transport equation will be something like, you know, this time you are transporting a density function, and then, sorry, maybe you will have here in divergence form or in non-divergence form, doesn't really matter, right? You can write it without the divergence form, right? Just write something like plus, and then here you have a vector field, which is WT sigma of AFT rho plus B, and then times rho equal to zero, right? And yeah, then it will be here x, the derivative on x, okay? So there are different ways of building mean field limits, right? In which, you know, this paradigm, you know, is made maybe more abstract or more, say, operator related. Of course, there are, this is a very simple example, the one I have given you. In practical applications, people use convolutional neural networks, for instance. So convolutional neural networks will be, you know, matrices or operators A, which are of a specific manner, right? In which you are simply making averages or convolutions, because in the discrete context, convolution is after all just some averaging of the elements of X, right? And then, of course, when the number of components in X goes to infinity, it is very natural to think that these convolutional neural networks lead to some integral operators on the density function, right? Yeah, I mean, you are totally right. There are many, many ways of getting into higher dimensional expressions of these models, in which eventually you are in an infinite dimensional context, and then the, say, operator approach or PDE perspective is much more natural. But frankly, I think to begin with, it's much better to remain at this finite dimensional level where understanding can be gained. Okay, so then we continue tomorrow at IMAT. Tomorrow is at 3 p.m. in Germany, right?
Yes, yes. Tomorrow is 3 p.m. Germany, yes.
And 2 in Morocco. I will continue with this, and I will explain you tomorrow what is the Rubik Cube principle that explains why neural networks and their control is so successful.